morning, everybody, and welcome to online worship with Birchcliff Bluffs United Church. My name is Aidan Legault, and I am a youth leader at Eglinton St. George's United Church in Toronto, as well as an MDiv student at Emmanuel College at U of T. I am so honored and so grateful to be joining the congregation of Birchcliff Bluffs United for worship this morning, August 16th, 2020, while the Reverend Greg Daly is on holiday. I want to extend greetings not only from myself, but also from the entire ministry team at Birchcliff Bluffs United. I want to offer a special thanks to music director Randy Vancour, whose gifts of music and digital editing are making our service this morning possible. Birchcliff Bluffs is an affirming congregation of the United Church of Canada, which means that the community seeks to welcome people of all backgrounds, of all gender identities, and of all sexual orientations. And it is our sincere wish that everybody who is joining us for worship today feels welcome and safe and comfortable sharing in the joy and the love and the peace of God. We begin our time together with a recognition of our relationship to the place that we now occupy. For millennia prior to the arrival of Europeans, the lands and waters upon which Toronto and Scarborough were built have been the traditional territories of many peoples and many nations. This congregation worships together on the traditional territory of the Huron and Petun First Nations, of the Seneca, and most recently of the Mississauga of the Credit and Scugog, part of the Williams Treaty. The city is home today to many diverse Indigenous, Inuit, and Métis people who continue to face discrimination and violence at the hands of our colonial state. We grieve together the broken covenants that have built this city and this country. And we recognize too our obligation as people of God, not simply to name the injustices taking place in our world, but also to serve as active participants in the healing of creation's wounds. I would ask that you pray this morning and this week, especially for all those land and water protectors across Turtle Island right now who are struggling to maintain the health and integrity of their traditional territories. I have with me a candle, and if you have one available, I would invite you to go and grab it so that we can light our candles together. We light these candles as a remembrance and a symbol of the great light that shines in our lives today and always, the light which is the love of God made flesh in his Son, Jesus Christ. As our lights burn together, I would invite you to take a moment to breathe and bring your heart and your soul and your mind to our service together. As we pray and I have with me a candle, and if you have one available, I would invite you to grab it so that we can light these together. We light our candles as a remembrance and as a symbol of the light that shines in our lives today and always, the light which is the love of God made flesh in his Son, Jesus Christ. As our flames burn together, I would invite you to take a moment to breathe and bring your heart and your spirit and your mind to our service today. Just as God's light shines for us, may we too shine for all of those people who find themselves in the shadowy places of the world, those people who are the victims of the great sins of racism and misogyny, homophobia and transphobia, poverty, and imperialism, and all of the other forms that evil takes. Creator God, we pray that you will guide our hands and feet as we build your kingdom on this earth. Amen. I would invite you now to join me in our call to worship, If you would like to, you can read the bolded section of this in unison with me. Behold, a new sun has risen, a new possibility is in the air. Though in the gloom of night we knew anger, we knew sadness, and we knew fear, this morning God has made all things new. In the light of God's new day, we know that we are cherished and beloved. With all our faults and all our fears, we are gathered today in love. With all our doubts and all our pains, we are gathered today in peace. Though we might find ourselves estranged by pain and by hurt, we are gathered today with grace. God binds our wounds, wipes away our tears, and walks alongside us as we seek to know new life. Let us remember today and every day that God's care for us is inescapable, God's mercy unwavering, and God's love steadfast. Let us give thanks and seek to love with such abandon. I would invite you now to join us for our first hymn this morning, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, found at Voices United 315. Surrounded by the staggering wonder of your creation. We see your hand in each star that twinkles in the sky, in each creature that flies, swims, or wanders across the earth, in the smiles of the ones we love, in each precious moment of our lives. We are so richly blessed, Lord, to be your people in your world. Too often, O God, we find ourselves pulled apart from each other, from you, sometimes from ourselves. Our world demands and commands so much of us that we allow our actions to be dictated, not by knowledge of you, but instead by anger, by jealousy, by arrogance, by fear, and by doubt. Absorbed by these, we lose sight of your vision for a righteous world, a peaceful world, and a just world. But you, Lord, are a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, and abounding in love and faithfulness. Even when we pull away, you hold us in your mercy. Even when we err, you pull us to our feet. Grant us the humble wisdom to know that it is not within our power to separate ourselves from your forgiveness. Empower us with the courage to show ourselves the gentleness we seek to show the world, and fill us with your Spirit, that we might know and proclaim the endlessness of your love today and always. Amen. Before we share in our scripture readings for today, I invite you to join me in a prayer for wisdom. God of the Word and Sacrament, Lord of history, as we share together in the wisdom of our faith, may we listen for your voice, remain open to your Spirit, and share in your truth. May we find in your scriptures and in your gospel new understanding, new energy, and new life. Amen.
This reading is from Genesis, chapter 45, verses 1 to 15. Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all those who stood by him, and he cried out, "Send everyone away from me." So no one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard it, and the household of Pharaoh heard it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him. So dismayed were they at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer to me." And they came closer. He said, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land for these 2 years, and there are 5 more years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. God sent me before you to preserve you for a remnant on earth, and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Hurry and go up to my father and say to him, 'Thus says your son Joseph, God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not delay. You shall settle in the land of Goshen and you shall be near me, you and your children and your children's children, as well as your flocks, your herds, and all that you have. I will provide for you there, since there are 5 more years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have will not come to poverty. And now your eyes and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see that it is my own mouth that speaks to you. You must tell my father how greatly I am honored in Egypt and all that you have seen. Hurry, bring my father down here.' Then he fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept, while Benjamin wept upon his neck. And he kissed all his brothers and wept upon them. And after that, his brothers talked with him."
Before we share in our second scripture reading, I invite you to join in singing More Voices number 90, "Don't Be Afraid."
Promised to be all.
following reading is from Romans chapter 11, verses 1 to 2 and 29 to 32. Israel's rejection is not final. I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means. I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Just as you were once disobedient to God, but have now received mercy because of their disobedience, so they have now been disobedient in order that, by the mercy shown to you, they too may now receive mercy. For God has imprisoned all in disobedience so that he may be merciful to all.
My first exposure to the story of Joseph probably came when I was a young child, in the form of the 1999 film version of Andrew Lloyd Webber's Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. When I was preparing for worship today, I actually went to YouTube and rewatched a bunch of clips from the movie, which I probably haven't seen since I was 7 or 8 years old. Each scene that I watched was just more bizarre than the last. So if you have time this summer and want to descend into one of the most deranged cinematic landscapes ever put to film, I would really encourage you to check this movie out. When I was poring over these videos, I felt like I had entered into this ancient, hidden part of my brain, like I was picking up these dusty, moth-eaten memories that I hadn't touched in a decade and a half. I could recall the fascination I felt watching in my family's living room as Donny Osmond twirled around the screen in a psychedelic bathrobe. I could remember my bafflement at the fact that Pharaoh was, for some reason, an Elvis impersonator. I was actually quite struck, though, by one memory that came through quite clearly and quite unexpectedly, which was that as a child, I had a very acute dislike of the character of Joseph. This really hit me. When I was a kid, I thought that Joseph, who was one of the Bible's great heroes, was actually just a bit too much of a goody-two-shoes for my liking. Even from the beginning of his story, Joseph, it seems, can do no wrong. He's his father's favorite child, so he gets nicer things than all of his siblings. He starts having these prophetic dreams in which he foretells that his older brothers will kneel down in reverence before him, and he very innocently alerts them of this. And eventually his brothers, sick and tired of him, conspire first to kill Joseph, and then they change their mind and sell him into slavery. But even when enslaved in Egypt to one of Pharaoh's officials, Joseph so excels at his subservience that he is made the head of his owner's household. After being falsely accused of attacking his master's wife, Joseph is thrown into prison. But even at this point, when everyone in the story has wronged him, Joseph is not angry, he's not rebellious, he's not vindictive. No, no. Joseph remains as sweet and useful as you could possibly want and helps to prophetically analyze people's dreams until, finally, he assists Pharaoh by foreseeing an impending famine and is, effectively, made the prime minister of Egypt by the sheer force of his goodness. In the final act of Joseph's story, his traitorous brothers appear before him to beg for food. They don't recognize him as the brother that they had sold into slavery for only 20 pieces of silver all those years before. It's the perfect opportunity for Joseph to have a human reaction, to punish the people who wronged him, to make use of the power that he built by the sheer force of his righteous goodness, to finally provide consequences for the crimes that were committed against him. That is what I expected to happen as a kid. And that's what would have happened in any other story that I would have been reading at the time, any fairy tale, any novel, any fable. The people who are in the right are rewarded, and the people who are in the wrong get their comeuppance. That's how justice worked in the moral universe of my childhood. And to some extent, that is still kind of how I conceive of the world. When people do wrong, some form of discipline is necessary to set things right. But that's not how Joseph's story ends. Instead, we get the scene from today's reading from Genesis. Joseph reveals himself to his understandably horrified brothers, and within the span of a heartbeat, forgives them and makes peace rejoicing in the fact that God had worked through their mischief to put him in a position to keep them fed and housed during the famine. They enjoy this tearful, loving reunion, and then the brothers set off to bring the whole family down to Egypt. This was a wildly unsatisfying conclusion to me as a child. Basically, every single person who does something heinously evil in the story gets away scot-free. I can see, and I could see, what the basic lesson of the story was. I mean, essentially, Joseph's story seems to suggest that the righteous course of action and the godly course of action is to choose gentleness over harshness, and to choose mercy over retribution, to allow love to guide decisions rather than anger. And all of these observations have value. But even now, I actually don't think it's altogether unreasonable to be frustrated at the conclusion of this story, particularly when we take into account what Joseph is so quickly forgiving. Recall that Joseph's brothers beat him. They planned and almost executed his murder. They sold him to slavers, and they tore apart their family out of petty jealousy. If the message that we're to draw from this text is that victims of these brutal forms of violence, which continue to occur in our own time, should perpetually play the role of the bigger person, that amnesty is always preferable to accountability, or that we shouldn't want those who willfully hurt people to be held responsible, then my issues with this story, and with Joseph, persist. I couldn't stand at a pulpit and tell somebody who has been abused or who has been victimized that the onus is on them to stop feeling hurt, to move on, to act without anger. I think it would be fundamentally unjust, actually, to insist that the need of an offending party to be forgiven eclipses the need of the injured party to acknowledge their pain. Perhaps, then, I need to dig a little bit deeper to understand the message that is going on under the surface of Joseph's story. I think I'm particularly interested in analyzing not just Joseph's act of forgiveness, but instead to see how forgiveness actually functions in the narrative. The chapters describing Joseph's life interestingly mirror the structure of a literary comedy. So we have Joseph, our protagonist, who begins at a position of esteem, of privilege, of power. And then through a series of mishaps, he descends into a position of precariousness and destitution. But through his virtues, he experiences this change of fortunes, and he returns to a position of power, and he gets his happily ever after moment. This is the way that comedies will often work. The hero of the story will find themselves in a position to exercise power to punish the people who have done them wrong over the course of their story. In any other version of this kind of narrative, Joseph's brothers, who are the antagonists of the story, would have probably ended this story on their hands and knees, scrubbing the floor or maybe peeling potatoes or something like that, while Joseph does get his happily ever after. That's what is supposed to happen. Heroes are supposed to give comeuppance to the people who have wronged them. I mean, I think, for example, of a story like Cinderella, which has a similar plot structure. Cinderella is in a position of privilege, but after the death of her father, her stepmother and stepsisters reduce her to servitude. But then good things happen to Cinderella. She's returned to a place of privilege and esteem. And her stepsisters get their punishment when they are forced out of their house, and in the Grimm Brothers version, have their eyes pecked out by birds, I think? Yeah. Joseph, however, not only opts not to do this, not to give his brothers their comeuppance, but instead goes so far as to do the opposite. This very much complicates our image of what forgiveness looks like in the text. Joseph doesn't use his newfound power to wipe the slate clean, or to declare everything at peace, or to say that that's all in the past. He doesn't say, "I permit you to walk free." He doesn't even tell his brothers, "I forgive you." Instead, he simply says, "Do not be distressed or angry with yourselves. God sent me before you to preserve life." Despite everything that has happened, despite the fact that Joseph has both the reason and the ability to punish his brothers for their wrongdoing, when he speaks to them, he makes clear that he is not interested in adjudicating them. He's not passing judgment on them. He is in no way exercising power over them, even to absolve them of their guilt. He approaches them as neither a victim nor as a superior. He does not ask them for an apology. He actually seems entirely disinterested in being compensated in any way for the crimes that have been committed against him. The more I think about this, the more radical it seems. The forgiveness that Joseph is offering them is not a pardon from on high. It's a forgiveness of debt. Joseph's brother owed him a great deal. At the very least, he was entitled to their remorse and was probably entitled to more, to seeing them disciplined, to seeing them get some form of punishment. But when presented with the power to extract from his brothers what was owing to him, he relinquished it. I think that's a far more complex and probably a far more challenging kind of forgiveness than what I had initially interpreted from this story. Joseph's forgiveness is not an action that he performs for his brother's benefit. It's not a gift that he gives them. Rather, it's a surrender of the power in which he holds them. In doing this, Joseph writes an entirely different kind of story. Despite everything that has been done, despite the expectations of readers like us, or maybe like me specifically, Joseph dissolves the distinction between himself as a hero and his brothers as villains. He washes away the identities that have been constructed in the story on the basis of culpability and victimhood. For Joseph, his reunion with his brothers is not an opportunity to be vindicated, not a time to demand repayment for the past. Instead, Joseph sees within his refound family an opportunity to do something new, to try again, to bring his family to Egypt and do better this time. Joseph sees and Joseph proclaims that through their mutual rediscovery of each other, God has given them the chance to experience a more abundant life, all of them, to grow together and to be changed and to be made richer. Their new relationship will not be one defined by righteousness in opposition to wrongdoing, but rather by a mutual capacity to be better than before. Thankfully, few people will ever find themselves in a situation quite like Joseph's. Few people will be as wronged as he was, and even fewer people will be put in a position of power to be able to pass the kind of judgment that he might have had he chosen to. Joseph's way of approaching compassion and mercy and forgiveness, however, is one that I think we can all learn something from, particularly when it comes to the relationships that we navigate in our daily lives. We humans spend a lot of time interacting with each other, whether in our families, in our workplaces, at school. We are in an almost constant state of bumping into each other, whether physically or emotionally. And when that happens, it's almost inevitable that some kind of wrongdoing will occur. Someone will say something or do something that offends you, or that upsets you, or that hurts you. And when that happens, you might find yourself in a position not altogether dissimilar to Joseph's. You will be in the right, and they will be in the wrong. And to be in the right is oftentimes quite an attractive prospect. There's a certain power that comes with it. You feel justified. You feel confident and more certain in the correctness of your position. You might get to decide whether to forgive your transgressor. You might get to decide whether to let them stew on what they've done for a bit longer. You might get to decide that you want to hold on to the pain that you've encountered and nurse it into a grudge. And you might even be in a position to inflict some kind of punishment on the person who has hurt you. I have definitely found myself on both sides of these stories throughout my life. I have been wronged, and I have done wrong. And I have found that it becomes very easy to allow my relationships to devolve into a kind of moral accounting, a tally of who owes who what apology, of who is entitled to feel indignant, of who is the good guy or the bad guy in a situation. Of course, it seems obvious that this is detrimental to the health of a relationship. About as obvious as the fact that Joseph's story teaches us the value of forgiveness. I think, though, that when we take the opportunity to think through forgiveness the way that Joseph does, to put his actions into practice in our own relationships and our own conflicts, we might encounter something wonderful, the way that Joseph did. Can you think of a time when you have been locked into a conflict with someone in your life? What role did you play? Were you the wrongdoer? Were you the judge? What did or what would it take to reach a resolution? The negotiation of forgiveness or an apology, maybe restitution, or a willingness on the part of those involved to look at the harm that has been done and see in it not a quarrel to be won, but an invitation to try again. Our second reading, Paul's letter to the church in Rome, picks up this conversation in a wildly different context and for wildly different purposes. Paul is interested not in redefining people's relationships with each other, but rather in explaining humanity's relationship to God. I unfortunately have spent too much time describing Joseph and the amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat to adequately discuss the entirety of the letter to the Romans, which is, I think, actually probably one of the most important Christian documents we have on record. But in the specific section that we've shared today, Paul is engaged in what seems to have been a very, very lively debate in the early Christian community over what exactly qualifies a person for salvation through Christ. Specifically, the excerpt that we've heard is Paul's attempt to answer a question that has persisted in Christian thought essentially since the beginning, and one that has prompted some of the most unspeakable evil in human history. In the nascent church, formed of both converted Jews and Gentiles, who understood themselves as being God's new chosen people, in a new covenant with God sealed with Christ's blood, the question arose, what about Israel? What about those Jews who have not converted to Christianity? The first chosen people, the first nation bound by covenant to the Lord. Are they in or are they out? Paul's answer is a complex one that is challenging to struggle with. But I think it is our reading from today that composes or best articulates what I interpret as his essential verdict. The gift and the calling of God are irrevocable. As I read this, and as I read it, this is a striking suggestion, almost uncomfortable to someone like me who was raised in a culture rooted in individualism and humanism. What I read in this is the proclamation that there is nothing within my power or yours, nothing that either of us can do to reject the love that God freely gives us, to decline God's gift of salvation. God has promised a new world for all, a new life for all, and come hell or high water, maybe literally, God will be faithful to us. Whether or not you are Christian, whether or not you have sinned, whether or not you see yourself as worthy, God gives you love utterly, totally, and irresistibly. You are entirely beloved by God. You are entirely worthy, and you are entirely sacred. I think that's what Paul's suggesting here. And when we turn back to Joseph, when we read of his loving mercy and his loving forgiveness, and we maybe understand that this is an explanation of the same care in which we are held by God, I feel that we are offered a new way of understanding how we can move in the world in relationship with God. We will transgress. We will sin. We will do things that hurt other people. We will fail over and over and over again to be perfect, because that is what it is to be a human being. I think we all know that. But in the light of our stories today, I hope you see, as I do, that God's will is not that you feel guilt. God's will is not that you be punished as a villain. God instead invites you to try again, to do better next time, and to tell a new story, assured in the knowledge that you are entirely beloved by the Lord. Thank you. I invite you to join now in singing Voices United, number 271, There's a Wideness in God's Mercy.
There's a wideness in God's mercy, like the wideness of the sea. There's a kindness in God's justice, which is more than liberty. There is no place where earth's sorrows are more felt than up in heaven. Troubled souls, why will you scatter like a crowd of frightened sheep? Foolish hearts, why will you wander from a love so true and deep? For the love of God is broader than the measures of the mind, and the
ministry of Birchcliff Bluffs United and the United Church of Canada is made possible through the generosity and support of our congregations and our supporters. If you have any interest in making a donation to support the life and work of this congregation and others, I would invite you to explore methods of financial support at bbuc.ca/donate. We recognize, though, that the gifts that we offer to one another, to our communities, and to our world take so many different forms. It's important to recall that every smile that we share, every kindness, every moment of fellowship, and every prayer is a precious and priceless gift that we offer to one another. It is this bounty that most deeply enriches us, especially when we find ourselves separated in one way or another. Wherever we gather in worship of our Lord, let us remember the sacred task that we bear, to be loving and beloved servants of all. Let us pray now in gratitude for all of the gifts that we offer to our neighbors and to our communities. Lord God Almighty, you have blessed us beyond measure with the gifts of life and love eternal. In the same way, we strive throughout our lives to offer our gifts, our talents, and our skills to your people. Help us as we do to remember those who are touched and changed by our giving. In the midst of challenging times, especially, Lord, when we are tired and frustrated and losing patience with a world that can seem chaotic and cruel, when we feel that we have given all that we can, help us to remember that in our hearts dwell the offerings of grace, mercy, and compassion. Treasures that stream forth from a source that never runs dry. We are the church. Our house is the house of the Lord, and the table we lay here is one of abundance without end. Amen. I want to once again thank everybody who is joining us today for allowing me to be a part of your worship this morning. And before we part ways, I wanted to share in a final prayer with everybody. This is a prayer that I wrote with a couple members of my youth group at Eglinton St. George's United Church, and I hope it is as meaningful to you as it was to us. Holy God, as we pray together, we recognize that we are all coming here from different places. Not only are we physically distant from one another, we also find ourselves in a variety of circumstances. Today, each of us brings to you our own griefs, our own joys, and our own needs, and we lay all of these before you. We pray for ourselves, we We pray for our loved ones, and we pray too for those who have no one to pray for them. In this time especially, we lift up our prayers for those whose plans and lives have been unraveled by the coronavirus pandemic. We pray for those who are lonely, who have lost their communities, their places of refuge, the places where they feel safe. May they remember that in you, they are never alone. We pray for those people who are burdened right now with new stresses, those who are overworked and exhausted, and those who are feeling directionless because of lost opportunities and vanished plans. Help them to cherish the surprising joys that this complex time can bring and allow them to hope for the future. We pray for all those struggling through sickness, particularly those who are doing so alone, that they may know that you are always at their side and holding them close, even when it is a struggle to maintain faith. We hold in our hearts those who are suffering from the more insidious sicknesses of our world, the diseases of war, hunger, poverty, and injustice. We pray for those people who are living under occupation and for victims of war, those who are being denied access to their land, their freedom, and the resources that they need. We pray for our neighbors who are right now struggling against the violence embedded in our own communities, those seeking to change the systems that do both us and them tremendous harm. Lord, may all who are hurting be healed, and may you give your church the compassion, wisdom, and courage to be a healing force in this world. Although it is not always easy, we have faith that with your guidance, spirit, and presence, we can live as disciples of your Son, Jesus Christ, who so long ago taught his followers to pray thusly. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Before we part ways, we have one final hymn to sing together. Behold, behold, I make all things new, from More Voices, number 115. Together today comes to an end. May you go now in peace and be a bearer of the good news of love's triumph for all the world. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us today, and I hope that maybe someday in the future I'll be able to come join you all for worship in person. Thanks so much, everybody, and have a great day.